Our precious Heavenly Father, God, we're just so thankful. By choosing you, we choose life. Because we can either accept you as Lord and Savior and be with you forever in heaven, or we cannot accept you and be eternal and live in eternal damnation. Father, it's our choice. I pray that everybody would get that set in stone before they walk out of here. And those of us that are Christians, to reevaluate our own lives and see where we stand with Jesus Christ. Are we serving him or are we serving self? Father, it's so important that we draw closer to you, especially in these days. Just like in Israel days when they were going so far from you and God would try to draw them back. Father, I believe that you're trying to draw us back now and to make more people aware that we're not guaranteed another day. Father, thank you so much for this time, and I pray for the service to follow. Father, I thank you for the praise music that we have, and Father, I'm just so thankful that we have a God that cares about everything about us, small to large. Thank you, Lord. And we say this in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. Thank you.
All right, good morning. If you would please stand and turn in your hymnals to page 11. Page 11, or it'll be on the screen behind us. We're going to sing all three verses. You may be seated. Next song will be on the screen behind us. We did this a while ago. If you know it, please sing with us.
Moving in the mist, I worship. worship you. I worship you.
You are here.
Turning lives all around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. Mending every heart. I worship you. That is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper,
light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are.
That is
who you are.
One more time.
You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God.
That is who you are.
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 Thank you. At this time, kids are dismissed to junior church, and we're going to have special music.
Shorter, so my bad.
Scatter words and empty thoughts seem to pour from my heart. I've never felt so torn before. It seems I don't know where to start. But it's now that I feel your grace fall like rain from every fingertip, washing away my pain. And I still believe in your faithfulness. And I still believe in your truth. And I still believe questions to fog up my mind with promises I still seem to bear. And even when answers slowly unwind, it's my heart I see you prepare. But it's now that I feel your grace fall like rain from every fingertip, washing away my pain. And I still believe in your faithfulness. still believe in your faithfulness. And I still believe in your truth. And I still believe in your holy word. Even when I don't see, I still believe.
The way she sings that, you could tell she believes what she sings. Amen. I mean, you could watch someone, you could tell when they really, that means something to you, doesn't it? I mean, that just, it just exuberated out of her, didn't it? I mean, is that the way, that's the way we sing in our cars. We try to sing like that in our cars when no one else is listening. You know, Mickey could do that in front of people, so, but we sing like that in the cars or on walks or things like that. Brittany, you lost your grandmother, right? So pray for Brittany, and then it's good to see another Brittany back with her boys, Bradley, Malachi, and Anthony that are here this morning, and good to see the Montgomerys here, Lynn and Rob, and think good to see Louise back from Tennessee, made it up from the holler, so, so, and my neighbor Denise came with me today, Denise, and the mic's not on, so Facebook Live couldn't hear any of that, that's okay. We'll be in Psalm 37 today. Psalm 37. You know, these things are life-changing. These words from the Lord are life-changing. These are something that we could take with us every day, every day. And it seems like when you see the world thriving and you leave for church and you see the next-door neighbor washing his Cadillac and you leave with a 01 Buick Century, and then David says, "Fret not because of evildoers." I'm not saying people that have nice cars or they're evildoers, but I'm saying a lot of times we think the world has it over us. We think that they have everything, and God is the great restrainer of keeping us from that. That's if nothing could be further from the truth. But we not need be envious of the unrighteous, because we know their end, right? This world is not our home. We're just sojourners on this earth. We shouldn't feel comfortable here. Because it's not our home. It's not our home. And this is all just a precursor for eternity. And the song says, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. These wheelchairs that Megan and Lisa are in, they'll be long forgotten in the face of eternity. Amen? They'll be long forgotten, because he's going to wipe away every tear from our eyes. And these two ladies have been so faithful, and I appreciate the workers from Individual Outcomes that bring them. And one day this shall pass. This too shall pass, these things that we're going through. We need not be envious of the unrighteous. And David, in Psalm 37, is writing this from the perspective of a man that has seen it all. And some of us here are up in years, and we've seen how God has been with us. And you younger ones are going to see how God just walks you through every step of the way. And you're here today because our theme verses today is Psalms 37:23. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this time you've given us. Thank you for these dear souls here. Thank you for the message and music by the praise team, and then Mickey individually, Lord, with that beautiful song. Lord, I just pray that you would honor this service, Father. Let the Holy Spirit move and work. These are the words of God that are spoken, not the words of me. Lord, let your Holy Spirit move and work. And if there's someone here today that doesn't know you as their Savior, that they would accept you freely today and acknowledge you as their Lord and Savior and the maker of their way for eternal life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So Psalms 23, you're here today because the Lord ordered your steps here. Do you believe that? The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. And notice it says, he delighteth in his way. Earlier in verse 4, it was a little bit different. It said that if you delight in the Lord, he'll give you the desires of your heart. If you delight in the Lord, he gives you the desires of your heart. So here's the understanding. Here's how it works. We delight in the things of God. You delight in everything about God. I know every time I see Lisa, she always wants a book or something about the Lord. I can truly say that Lisa Fleming delights in the Lord. She delights in hearing about the Lord. She delights in being around godly people. She delights in anything, any material, any scripture reading. We need to delight in the things of the Lord. And we do that because we know that the world doesn't fulfill. The world isn't going to give us our fulfillment. I hope we've learned that by now. His desires become our desires. We delight in the Lord, and his desires become our desires. The world's allure just isn't there anymore. Have you noticed as you become a believer and if you've grown in the Lord that the worldly things grow strangely dim to you? That the things that you thought you needed before, you know that you don't need? Have you gotten like that in your life? Things that you gave your life to, you realize that they were nothing to you now, and your desire is for the Lord. He gives us the desires of our heart because now we desire the things that are of God. Is that understood? He gives you the desires of your heart because now you desire his things. And then we then saw in verse 5, a great verse that we should all commit to memory. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. So let me put this together. His desires become our desires. And then we commit everything to him. We commit everything to him. The small things, the big things. My girls have gone through decisions with work and where they have their futures at. I know some of you like had to ponder. I know Mickey went through a move recently. So you commit your ways to the Lord. Then you trust in him as a result. When you commit your way to him, you trust in him as a result. Then he brings it to pass. Have you seen that in your life where you turn something over to the Lord, you trust in him, and then he brings it to pass? And then you look back at your life and say, he did bring it to pass. The problem is we missed that last step. We failed to look back and say, you know, as I look back through my life, he did bring it to pass. What does he bring to pass? His plan in your life. His working in your lives. He desires great things for you. And the problem is when we get involved, it's a plot. We try to scheme and manipulate and do things like that. But when God does it, it's not a plot, it's a plan. Amen? When God does it, it's not a plot, it's a plan. He has great thoughts towards us, and he wants us to give us the desires of our heart. So his desires become our desires. And then so with our desires in the right place and our ways committed to him, he then begins to order our steps. You see that? Our desires are in the right place, our ways are committed to him, and then he orders our steps. There's many today that don't know him and put their trust in worldly things, and their steps are anything but ordered. Their steps are anything but ordered. They're misordered. It says the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Our desires are right. We commit our ways to him. We trust in him, and then he orders our steps. Have you seen that in your life? If you haven't seen that, trust him as your personal Savior. Because he'll be the anchor of your soul. And then as we take those steps, as we walk in the way, then he delights in it. He delights in our way. He watches us and he delights in it. And it all started with us first delighting in the Lord. And then now he in turn delights in us. Psalm 23b. You all know the 23rd Psalm, right? Psalm 23, the first part of verse 5, he leadeth me, or actually that's verse 3, I think I messed that up. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. So he'll lead you along, he'll order your steps for his name's sake. Because he'll delight in you, and as you grow in him, it's like a proud father or mother watching their daughter perform a musical recital or something like that. I remember very clearly, my dad used to have me mow the lawn. And he'd sit out there in the backyard with his white t-shirt, his plaid shorts, his black shoes, and his black socks. That was the style back in the 60s, right? 60s or 70s. And he'd sit back there with on the lawn chair, and one of those lawn chairs that had those little bands that always rip up. You remember those? Those ones that are nylon. And he'd sit back there with a quart of tea, and he'd sit back there and watch me mow the lawn. And here's how that worked. I delighted in him. I wanted to do well for my dad. I delighted in him. And then as he was watching me mowing, he delighted in me. You see that? I delighted in him, and I wanted to mow that lawn properly. Hey, you missed a spot, Ricky. Where I wouldn't overlap the wheels properly. You missed a spot. I delighted in him, and then he delighted in me. See how that works? A good man's steps are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in them. He delights in them. And let's think of how God orders our steps in the manner of a shepherd leading his sheep. Because we're just basically sheep, right? We're defenseless. We're helpless characters. We're susceptible to foolishness. Things, missteps, frustrations, blunders, poor decisions. We need help, don't we? Especially men. It was in Scripture in Genesis, it says it was not good that men should be alone, right? Men need help particularly. And we all need help as sheep. As it says in Isaiah 53:6, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the song, I found it ironic, Brandon and them saying, the praise team saying, come thou fount. And there's a phrase in there. It says, prone to wander. Are we not? Isn't that not true of us? Prone to wander. But thanks be to God, a good man's steps are ordered by the Lord. Now, what does ordered mean? What does ordered mean? It means that these steps are strengthened. These steps are established. These steps are made firm. These steps are fixed. They're anything but wishy-washy steps. Amen? These steps are ordered and authored and directed and planted firmly by the Lord. I remember when Vision Stadium down there at the University of Akron was being built. And I love stadiums. So I drove down there to look at this new facility as they were building it. And the lot outside the stadium was, it's a far cry from the Rubber Bowl that this guy used to play at. Jeff was a kicker for Akron U, and that was a nasty place, wasn't it? But this Infocision Stadium, if you've driven by there, is beautiful. So I drove down there, and the lot was full of mud outside of it. And I noticed the only way to get across and look at the stadium was that there were steps that were already depressed into the mud. So those steps became a little bit hardened, and I walked on those steps. And see, that's how God does. He orders our steps in this manner. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. They're fixed, they're established, they're made firm, they're strengthened, they're polished. So, real briefly here this morning, let's look at how the Good Shepherd, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, orders our steps from the perspective of the 23rd Psalm. You all know the 23rd Psalm. Firstly, how does he order our steps? He supplies. Isn't that a great word? He supplies. He supplies. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He supplies all of our needs. I don't have this verse up there, but you all know Philippians 4:19, but my God shall supply all our needs according to the riches that are in Christ Jesus. He meets our needs as he orders our steps. And David talked about this. Remember, this is an older King David talking about how the Lord took care of him and ordered his steps. He said, I have been young. This is in verse 25 of Psalm 37. I've been young and I've been old. Now I am old. Yet not have I seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. Even in the roughest time. I know my grandfather's birthday would have been today, August 8th, 1900. On August 8th, 1988, he was 88 years old. If you were born in 1900, you went through a lot. You went through a lot. You went through World War I, which started, I believe, in 1914. You went through the Spanish influenza, which started right after the, the Civil War. So when you were a teenager, you went through World War I, you went through the Spanish influenza that struck this country harder than what we've seen now. And then you went through not only that, but you went through the Great Depression, which started in 1929. His birthday would have been then, but would have been today. And he always talked about, I've been young and I've been old, yet not have I seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread, because this was a man that went through the Great Depression. Some of you went through rough times. Some of you single moms have been through rough times, and you could testify that the Lord has never forsaken me nor enabled us to put food on the table. Amen? So he orders our steps. He supplies. That's what he does when he orders our steps. Secondly, he steadies. He steadies. And boy, do we need steady steps these days, don't we? Psalm 23:2. A, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. Doesn't that sound good? Sleeps, our sheep are defenseless characters. They have really no way to defend themselves. They don't have sharp teeth. They don't have great horns. They don't have sharp talons or anything like that. Their complete and utter reliance is on a shepherd. Sounds like us, doesn't it? Understanding this, it's no small task for the shepherd to get a defenseless and timid creature to lie down. Most of us have a hard time being still. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He orders our steps by steadying us. Many of us have difficulty with anxiety. I've heard more and more of people having difficulty with anxiety. I'm surprised how much of that I hear. But he steadies us. He steadies us. In his remarkable book, A Shepherd's Look at the 23rd Psalm, Philip Keller said this. He said, owing to a sheep's makeup, it's almost impossible for them to be able to lie down unless four requirements are met. And he listed those requirements. And he said, due to their timidity, they refuse to lie down unless they are free from fear. And that's true with us. Secondly, because of the social behavior within the flock, sheep will not lie down unless they are free from friction with others of their kind. So you notice that you have in your life friction with somebody. It's hard to lie down and be steady and be at ease. Thirdly, if the sheep are tormented by fleas or paradise, they won't lie down. And finally, sheep will not lie down as long as they are hungry. So, interestingly enough, how are these needs met? And that comes down to the shepherd. It is the shepherd who makes it possible for them to lie down, to rest, to relax, to be content and quiet and flourishing. And Philip Keller, in his study of sheep, and as a shepherd, he came up with a conclusion about sheep. And he said, I came to realize that nothing so quieted and reassured the sheep as to see me, the shepherd, in the field. The presence of their master and owner and protector put them at ease as nothing else could do. And this applied day and night. You know what, is that true with you, that he steadies you? He steadies you. When you sense the Lord's presence, you see that he orders your steps by steadying you. You remember, was it Peter that walked out on the water? Was it Peter? And then when he began to sink, it was only because he took his eyes off Christ. Was that right? He steadies us. He orders our steps by not only supplying our needs, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, but along the way, he provides us with supernatural steadiness simply by his presence. That's the steadiness we need to get through life. I know I was talking to the boys. They're getting ready to start school here pretty soon. You need that steadiness in your life as you go through. Thirdly, he satisfies. He leadeth me beside the still waters, Psalms 23, 2b. He leadeth me beside the still waters. So how often do we have missteps in our lives because we seek fulfillment in things which simply do not fulfill? They'll never quench our thirst, these things. Worldly things like possessions, prestige, personal relationships, none of these things. You get them and you're like, is that all there is? Is that all there is? Steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and part of that is him leading us to still satisfying waters. We as believers whose steps are ordered by the Lord understand fully that Christ is the only one that can bring fulfillment in our lives. You've tried everything else, haven't you? You've tried those things, and you came to the same conclusion Solomon did when he said that all is vanity and vexation. He saw that after he had everything in his life. Jesus in John chapter 4, ladies, we've been talking about this on Thursday night at our Bible study at Talmadge Acres. John chapter 4, he had an interesting interaction with a Samaritan woman by the well. Remember that? It was about noontime. It was a time where they normally didn't draw water. And he asked the Samaritan woman, you remember the passage, he asked her to give him to drink, right? And she wondered, why would this Jewish man, that didn't normally Jews did not get along with Samaritans, why would he ask her to give him drink? And this was what his answer was in verse 10 of John 4. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God and who it was that said to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman said unto her, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? So she's like, you don't even have anything to draw the water out. How are you going to give me living water? But he wasn't talking about literal water. And she said, are you greater than your father, our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? See, her forefather Jacob dug this well. And he said, whosoever drinketh this water shall thirst again. In other words, worldly things are going to keep you unquenched. Unquenched. But then his answer, he went on further in verse 14. Whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give them shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Jesus was telling her that the water you're drinking, you're going to continually get thirsty. But the water that I'm offering is going to give you eternal life, and you're going to be never thirsty again. These are the waters that Christ offered, waters that he said shall spring up into everlasting life. You know what? We often seek after things that we know the end result is non-fulfillment. And the Jews did this. Jeremiah wrote of this in Jeremiah 2. He says, my people have committed two evils, Jeremiah said. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters. Now, the possessor of this earth, the ruler of the universe, the maker of all things, we often forsake him, do we not? We have a great God at our disposal, and we forsake, who's called here, the fountain of living waters. What do they forsake him for? They've hewed them out cisterns. In other words, they cut out of stone these open areas to put water, broken cisterns that can hold no water. And that's something we have at our disposal, the fountain of living waters, the one that's going to fulfill our lives and to work out his purpose in us and order our steps. But we actually go after water from broken cisterns. And what happens to a broken cistern? Mud gets into that cistern. Dirty, clogged, or dirty, messy, darkened water. Don't forsake God for waters from broken cisterns. A man's steps are anything but ordered if he craves water from these type of things. So a good shepherd knows that there's three different ways that you can feed the sheep. You can feed it from the dew in the morning on the grass, wells or springs, or streams. So those are three different things. Wells, the dew, and then also springs. And there's no more a picture of still waters than silver droplets of the dew hanging heavy on leaves and grass at the break of day. So that shepherd has to get up early with those sheep and lead them out there in the pasture so they can drink of the dew off of the grass. And it's interesting, in the morning it seems like that's when the real quietness comes. You ever notice that? It's no misnomer that those who are the most serene, most confident, and able to cope with that day's troubles are those who rise up each early that morning to feed on God's word. Do you ever try to read the word of God at night? What happens? You knock right out. But just like the shepherd leads that sheep out to the water to draw upon the Lord and his goodness and his living water to eat, drink of that dew on those blades of grass, It's incumbent on us in those quiet early hours of the morning to imbibe on the word of God. So, finally this, he establishes us. He establishes us. So, he, in verse 3a, he restoreth my soul. He restoreth my soul. So, we've seen that he supplies. We've seen that he steadies. We've seen that he satisfies. Now we're going to see that he satisfies us. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. As we take those steps, and they're ordered by God, and they're established by God, they're strengthened by God. Sometimes, though, we get kind of down in the dumps. Even David, who wrote both the 23rd Psalm and the 37th Psalm, knew what it was like to be cast down and dejected and discouraged. Sometimes we need, do we not, restoration. I know VBS wore me out, and Katie all ran that, did a great job, but it was a rough week. We need restoration after weeks like that, don't we? And David understood that. He had tasted defeat in his life. He had tasted people rejecting him. He had tasted people rebelling against his leadership as a king, his own son Absalom. So he felt the frustration of not feeling restored. And later he talked about that in Psalms 37. He says, though he fall, this is verse 24, he shall not be utterly cast down. There's times in your life where you just need restoration. I think, have you ever related to that? I mean, August is a tough month for me. I don't know. I was talking to Stephanie about that the other day. I think around here we like the fall, don't we? We like October and November because it's approaching the holidays. August is kind of a tough month. It's at the end of summer. You know, it speaks of going back to school. I don't want to talk about that, but it's a tough month. But it says, though he fall, in verse 24, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. So what does he do as he orders our steps? He establishes us. He holds his hand out, and he grabs us out of that miry clay. And David just went through this stuff time after time. In 42:11, he said this to himself, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted within me? Help thou in God. So he was saying, why do I feel this way? Did you ever get like that? Why am I cast down, O my soul? But we need to realize that he not only supplies for us, but he also establishes us. He'll restore us when we go through those down periods. Now, let me finish with this. There's an interesting parallel in the world of shepherds. In the caring for the sheep, sometimes sheep actually get what's called cast down or cast. And sometimes they get into a spot where, you know, maybe they're laying down and it's kind of like, remember that toy, Weebles Wobbles, but they won't fall down type of thing? That's kind of dates me. But sometimes, like, if they lay down, maybe if they have too much fur, maybe if they have too much weight, or maybe just the position they're in, is there a picture of that behind me? They can't get back up. And that is called a cast sheep. And that's where we get the term downcast. So it's really a pathetic sight. You can see that picture there. They're lying on their back, their feet's in the air, flailing away frantically, struggling to stand up without success. It almost reminds me of someone I went to the Waterworks Park with one time, went to the Lazy River and went in one of those tubes. They fell down in the tube and their feet were sticking straight up in the Lazy River. You ever see that? It wasn't a pretty scene, but lying on their back, feet in the air, flailing away, struggling to stand up. So if the shepherd doesn't get to the sheep in a reasonably short time, guess what's going to happen? That sheep's going to die. Because when that sheep is cast, it's susceptible to predators. Let's parallel that to our lives. When you're downcast, you're very much susceptible to predators. When you're downcast. And when you're at a difficult season in your life, that's when the devil's going to come in and try to rip your soul away. Thank God that in John 10 it says, my Father which gave them me, John 10, 27, 29, is greater than me, and no man shall pluck them out of my Father's hand. But when you're downcast, if you don't get righted, there's a likelihood where a predator can come in. That's where Jesus comes into play. That's where he comes down. Do you ever get cast down? Thanks be to God that we have a shepherd that orders our steps and delights in our path, and he's going to establish us. He's going to establish us. Time and time in Scripture, we see that. You remember when Peter denied the Lord not once, not twice, but how many times? Three times on the day of his being led away to crucifixion, and the Lord restored him. So how are your steps ordered? The Lord will restore your soul and establish you. That's the person that has his steps ordered by the Lord. And as we close with this. So today we've gone over another profound verse in Psalm 23. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, established by the Lord, fixed by the Lord, strengthened by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way, just like my dad did when I mowed that lawn right. I delighted in him and he delighted in me. I challenge you today in summary to first do this. Delight in the Lord, like Lisa does. Delight in the Lord. Secondly, commit your way to the Lord. Thirdly, trust in him. As you do this, he'll order your steps. I guarantee you that. He'll order your steps. God willing, next week we're going to go through how more ways that he orders our steps. And as God orders these steps, he will not only supply all of our needs, he will steady us. You remember the sheep that had a difficulty being steady because of their fear? He will satisfy us with those living waters, and he will establish us. Amen. Let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, today watch over us, Lord. And if there's anyone here today that didn't remember a time when they surrendered your life to you, Father, and acknowledge you as their personal Savior, Lord, I just pray that they would come up here and accept you today. They could do it at their seats. That's fine. They know they could do it at their seats. But Lord, there's something about testifying to the world that you are God. There's something special about that. That you want to tell the world that you're a sinner and that you need a Savior. And you want to show everyone that. Lord, I just pray if there's one person like that that knows that their ways aren't ordered by the Lord, that they know their lives are out of kilter. They know that they have anything but order in their life. Lord, I just pray that there be one person today that wants order in their life in this chaotic world that we live in. Lord, let them come to know this order by knowing you as the shepherd, the bishop of their souls. Bless us, Lord, as we go. Be with those that couldn't make it today. Be with the Whitsons, Lord, that just moved in from West Palm Beach and are waiting for all their stuff to get delivered up here. Watch over us, Lord, as we go. In Jesus' name I pray.